Presbyterian Church. My name is Reverend Jacob Van Furness. I have joy and pleasure to welcome you this morning as you're gathered here at Grace for worship, or if you're gathering with us online. We're grateful that you have chosen to spend time this morning together as a community of faith, of worshiping and learning and growing in our knowledge about God together. At Grace, we are a community that values engagement and belonging, compassion, community, and service. And over the past few weeks and moving forward, we're looking at how to be brave in these values and be brave as a community of faith in sharing these values. And so there are a number of things in your bulletin around things that are happening here at Grace, but I want to highlight a few as we come together to make sure that you're aware of them. So today and on Tuesday, there are some listening circles on the strategic plan that has been developed for 2022 through 2024. So if you are interested as to the course that Grace has set out for the next few years, I invite you to attend. You can bring questions, you can come and hear about where we are going and what we're thinking. So I invite you to do that, and you can sign up to do that through the office, and so you can also do that through the website. So I just invite you to come and be a part of those listening circles around the strategic plan. Those listening circles are coming in front of our congregational meeting, which is going to be in 2 weeks' time. And so the agenda for the congregational meeting is to get some ministry updates, a lead minister search update, to elect some interim session elders and approve the budget for 2022 and again, learn about that strategic plan. So I invite you to think about that. We'll have an update on COVID protocols and usage of the building. And again, please either register through the website or through the office. And that meeting will be on Zoom, and it'll be at 7 p.m. So just note that in your calendars. There are a couple of other things that I'll draw your attention to as well. We have a couple of book studies going on. The first one is the Being Brave book study, the Brave Church book study. And today and on Wednesday, we'll be talking about domestic violence. So having brave conversations around domestic violence. And so invite you to come and be a part of the conversation. And you'll see more information around that in the bulletin. There are a number of upcoming learning opportunities, and so I invite you to think around this. Preaching Grace, we're going to have Reverend Dr. David Wilkinson here, and he's going to talk about faith in a scientific world. And so you can register for that right now, and so invite you to do so. Grace has been on this journey of truth and healing and reconciliation and reconciliation. And this actually has been going on for some time, but when we had red paint splattered on our doors earlier this summer, we knew that we needed to take this journey of truth and healing and reconciliation and reconciliation seriously. So we have a book study that's coming up, and it's the book These Mountains Are Our Sacred Places, The Story of the Stony People. And it's going to be led by the Reverend John Snow Jr. Chief and Reverend John Snow wrote the book. His son, Reverend John Snow Jr., is going to lead that along with his brothers Bill and Tony. And so the book right now is kind of hard to acquire, but through John Snow Jr., we can get the book for $15. The used copy price right now on Amazon is about $683. So we're inviting people to sign up
And we can get you a book for $15. So if you would sign up after worship, and we're trying to get people registered, we'll open this up to the community as well, by November 15th. So you can sign up today after worship, or you can sign up through the office or the website, just so that we have a book for you. And that book study is going to happen in January, so I'm excited for that. We're also going to be offering a Kairos blanket exercise on November 28th in the afternoon, so that's a Sunday afternoon at 1 p.m. And the blanket exercise is meant to build understanding about our shared history as Indigenous and non-Indigenous peoples in Canada by walking through pre-contact, treaty-making, colonization, and resistance. This exercise will be led by some folks from Kairos and an Indigenous elder, and so it is it's a fantastic exercise to be a part of, to continue on in the journey of truth and healing and reconciliation and reconciliation. And so I invite you to sign up, and it's limited to 35 people. We've opened this up to the community, and there's been quite a bit of uptake. So if you're interested in participating, sign up soon, please. And a couple of other things just to draw your attention to in our bulletin, the thank yous. On Sunday, October 31st, in our parking lot, our trunk and treat event, we had over 200 children come. So thank you to those of you who were there with cars, those who donated candy. What a great thing. Cake bake. I just invite you to take a look at the thanks to the volunteers and supporters, names listed in the bulletin. I won't read them all. Coming up, we have our reset gift bags. And so if you have different beauty products that you would be willing to donate, there is a bin outside. You can donate them through the office. And Joni, those gift bags will go out on December 12th. Is that when you're making them? So yeah, so if you could bring donations prior to December 12th, that would be great. And those go to Reset, which is an organization that helps women who have been trafficked or are part of the sex trade escape that. And we're so grateful to support Reset in this way. The gift bags, Joni and some volunteers put them together, and they're made for all of the women who are a part of the Reset program as a way of providing some Christmas cheer. So invite you to donate. You can also make financial donations for that as well. I won't point out anything else in the bulletin, but I will invite us as we come together to remember the family and friends of Jim Gibson. Jim passed away on Thursday, and the service for Jim is being planned, and there'll be more information upcoming around that. So I invite you to pay attention for that. As a community of faith, we gather this morning to remember and recall that we are a group of people who are living into a vision of being transformed by God's grace, and that we're living into a mission that we are inspired by the Holy Spirit to grow as disciples of Jesus Christ, to love our neighbors, and to affect social change. So as we gather in this place, on the beauty of this day, surrounded by mountains and rivers, fields and trees and people from across the world, let's remember that we gather in a spirit of truth, and we honor and acknowledge that we live, work, and play on the traditional territories of the Blackfoot Confederacy, the Siksika, the Kainai, the Piikani, the Tsuut'ina, and the Stoney Nakoda nations that are made up of the Bearspaw, Chiniki, and Wesley peoples, the Métis Nation Region 3. And we gather together as all people who make our homes in the Treaty 7 region of Southern Alberta. So let us come together as we remember and recall with honor and truth that we are a people together, a country that remembers how we have been formed, and that there are people who have given their lives for our freedoms today. So let us enter into an act of remembrance on this Remembrance Sunday.
The souls of the righteous are in the hand of God. Their bodies are buried in peace, but their names live forevermore. At the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, time stands still for a moment, and we remember those who died not for war, but for a world that would be free and at peace. Please stand for the last post, a moment of silence, and our act of remembrance.
In Flanders fields, the poppies blow between the crosses, row on row, that mark our place, and in the sky, the larks still bravely singing fly, scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead, short days ago. We lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe. To you from failing hands we throw. The torch be yours to hold it high. If ye break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields.
Mm-hmm.
They shall grow not old, as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. We will remember them. I invite you to join us in singing the first verse of O Canada. Friends, as we remember, we gather together as people bringing our praise, our lives, our very selves before God. And so, as I stated earlier, our vision is that we would be transformed by God's grace and that we would be inspired by the Holy Spirit to grow as disciples of Jesus Christ. Love our neighbors and affect social change. So let us take a moment and ask ourselves, are we open to the transformation that God's grace offers? And are we willing to grow as disciples of Jesus Christ, inspired by the Holy Spirit, to love our neighbors and affect social change? As we center ourselves and prepare to enter into a space where God's grace is alive, where the Spirit is moving, and where we are called. So let us center ourselves as we light the Christ candle and pray this prayer. Lord of creation, create in us a new rhythm of life, of days that heal, rather than destroy. to join me in our responsive call to worship this morning and join your voices with mine in the parts of the bulletin that are bold. We come to worship this morning from different places. O God, do not be far from us. We come to worship this morning for different reasons. O God, do not be far from us. We experience the presence of the Spirit in different ways. O God, do not be far from us. We hear Jesus' words with different ears. O God, we thank you for drawing near to us in this place, in our lives. Be near to us now and open our hearts. Amen. I'll invite you to join me in singing our hymn, O God, our help in ages past, and you're invited to rise in body or in spirit as we sing these words together.
I invite you to join me in our prayers of adoration and confession. The prayer of confession is in bold for us to say together, and our assurance of pardon is responsive today. Let's pray. God of justice and peace, we gather at this solemn time of year, aware of the costliness of human history. In the face of hostility between nations and neighbors, you have come to us in Jesus Christ, carrying no sword, calling us to serve as peacemakers. In this time of worship, renew in us the hope that you will turn swords into plowshares and lead the world you love away from the study of war to the promise of peace with justice for all your peoples. God of justice and mercy, we confess that the world around us is in a mess. Countries turn disputes over territory into threats of terror. Old enemies stir up conflict within their tribes and nations, Threats of violence keep us all on edge. We confess we have not learned from past conflicts what leads to peace with justice among nations and neighbors. Forgive us and lead us in a better way. Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you." Through God's mercy, all our sin is forgiven. May the peace of Christ be with you. Also with you. I'll invite you to rise again as we sing our hymn, "Jesus, Life of All the World." Scripture reading today comes from Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through to 13. If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility, regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not only in my presence, but much more now in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
On this Remembrance Sunday, we take time to pause to remember those who gave their life in service, but we also pause to remember some of the events in our nation's history. And it's not meant to glorify things or to make us feel shame or guilt, but as we think about our prayers, to learn from them, as we think about the words in the poem, the torch being passed on to us to learn the cost of peace and justice in our world, to be what it takes for us to make sure that the lessons of the past aren't repeated. In addition to being Remembrance Sunday, we also take time to acknowledge our ongoing journey of truth, healing, and reconciliation. So I want to read today a book called I Lost My Talk. It says, I Lost My Talk. The talk you took away. When I was a little girl at Shubenacadie School, these pages have no words, it's just children in the classroom. You snatched it away. I speak like you. I think like you. I create like you. The scrambled ballad about my word. Two ways I talk, both ways I say. Your way is more powerful. So gently, I offer my hand and ask, let me find my talk. So I can teach you about me. That's the end. It's a short book, but I think it's powerful and helpful for us to remember as we think about that vision statement, transforming lives through God's grace, what it means for us to be open to that transformation, as Reverend Jake asked, are we open to that transformation? It starts with truth, it starts with healing, and moves on to reconciliation. It's not just about Indigenous peoples, it's also about us being willing to offer a listening ear, to listen and to learn, not just being quick to speak, but also being willing to learn from the lessons of the past. We have plaques of those who served in a role of honor for World War I and II. Peace is costly. Let's not forget that. Perhaps after the service, you can take some time to look and reflect on those names. But let's pray and remember the call. Each of us has, young and old, to work for peace. I invite you to repeat after me. Dear God, we thank you for the lessons of the past. Please help us to remember them and to learn from them. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I wear my emotions on my sleeve, so I think I've cried in just about every congregation I've served in, this being the exception, so holding it at bay for now, but we'll see what happens. It's really great to be together after such a long period apart with COVID regulations. The sermon I'm going to preach isn't necessarily easy for me. I know we're all coming into today's service with different feelings and emotions. It's a heavy Sunday with Remembrance Sunday, but also as we acknowledge the suffering and the cost of wars, and perhaps we know family members or friends who served in the war. But also as we talk about healing and reconciliation, as we celebrate milestones in our own lives, some of us are celebrating birthdays, some of us we haven't seen together in a long time. Physically, we might see their faces on Zoom or something, but it's really great to be together. But we also come in with the messiness of our lives, a sense of loss, a sense of sorrow. The family of Jim Gibson, who mourns his passing. So there's not always good times to preach tough sermons. I think today's one of those Sundays, so I'll ask for your patience and understanding. So, Philippians. Paul wrote this letter from prison, probably while under house arrest in Rome. Paul's primary purpose in writing this letter was to thank the Philippians for the gift they had sent him upon learning of his detention at Rome. However, he makes use of this occasion to fulfill several other desires, to report on his own circumstances, to encourage the Philippians to stand firm in the face of persecution, to rejoice, to exhort them to humility and unity, as we read today, to commend Timothy and Epaphroditus to them, and to warn them against other ideologies. The city of Philippi was named after King Philip II of Macedon. You might know of his son, Alexander the Great. It was a prosperous Roman colony, which meant the citizens of Philippi enjoyed the benefits of Roman citizenship. Many of the Philippians were retired military men who had been given land in the vicinity and who in turn served as a military presence in this frontier city. That Philippi was a Roman colony may explain why there were not enough Jews to permit the establishment of a synagogue, and while Paul does not quote the Old Testament in this letter. Paul is writing not only to teach theology, but to call the church to unity on the basis of the humility and servanthood of Jesus Christ. Along with unity, Paul appeals for humility. Believers are to be characterized not by selfish ambition or conceit, but by humility. This entails esteeming others and their interests more highly than one's own concerns. Contextually, this humility is grounded in Christ's humbling himself to the point of crucifixion. I think this is worth emphasizing as we probably become desensitized to its significance over time and simply repetition. Jesus, God in the flesh, who has all the power in the cosmos to raise Lazarus from the grave, to restore sight to someone blind, to walk on water, to feed multitudes, Jesus, all-powerful, is subjected to death by those seeking to keep power and to keep things the same. Jesus' message of restoration and love is too challenging for the Jewish authorities, who in turn seek approval from the Romans to have Jesus crucified. A death so painful, they made a new word to describe the pain involved: excruciating. Ex meaning out of, and crux meaning the cross. Crucifixion was also shameful because it was the worst way to die. It was reserved for the worst offenders, and after taking a long time to die, it opened them up to the ridicule of being mocked within earshot of bystanders and observers. It was a death so painful and shameful that Roman citizens, like the Philippians, couldn't be killed this way. It was too degrading, too humiliating for people of a certain standing in the world, unlike the uncivilized barbarians who could be subjected to this death in the opinion of the Romans. This is what Jesus was subjected to. This is what it means that he humbled himself, God in human flesh, and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. In an honor-shame society like the Roman world, the shame stands in stark contrast to the honor-seeking that prevailed among Roman aristocrats in society. Paul does not recommend a traditional way of upward mobility and aspiration, but rather a direction of downward mobility. The way of relinquishing self and honoring others, seen foremost in the life of Christ. The first four verses in this chapter read as one long singular sentence in the original Greek, making Paul's appeals to unity and to humility inseparable. In Paul's mind, humility is a necessary ingredient for community unity. And true humility is measured not by low self-evaluation, but by demonstrable concern for others. This past Tuesday, there was a presbytery meeting over Zoom. As part of a time of worship and reflection, we were asked to consider how the Presbytery of Calgary MacLeod can do justice, love kindness, and act in humility. We went into breakout rooms and regathered, sharing how we thought the presbytery could address some of these key Christian values. Just about all of the groups shared how we can do more around justice, whether around the climate or reconciliation with Indigenous peoples. We spoke about how we can be kinder with one another and how some of our processes and committees are designed to provide kindness and love with and for each other. But nothing was really said around humility. Each group, whether because of time addressing the first two, did not, for whatever reason, tackle how we can be humble. Isn't it interesting? And I dare say grace might have acted similarly. Let's be frank, in a world, generally speaking, and overly simplistic, in a world of haves and have-nots, grace is in the former. Somewhat anecdotally, describing the early 1900s, I heard that someone say the railway owners worshipped at Grace and the railway employees worshipped at St. Andrews. I can't say if that's true. I don't know how the validity of the statement. But perhaps we can acknowledge that many of us at Grace, past and present, are accustomed to a certain level of influence and affluence. Now, I'm not saying that to shame anyone. Let's be clear, we're blessed with a number of resources. We have a beautiful building and sanctuary in a beautiful location. We have a plethora of volunteers and skilled individuals who are part of this community. Yet with all of this, we also have an opportunity to identify our blind spots. In part of the church consultant work with the Reverend Dr. Graham Standish, it was shared that Grace has a history of doing for rather than doing with. It's a simple difference, but a significant one. And it's not always a bad thing, but it can present obstacles to how and why we do what we do. Think of a child with homework and a parent or older sibling. You know, the parent or older sibling might be able to just do the homework in a matter of minutes and it's finished. The job's done. But doing the homework with the child takes more time. It's slower, it still gets the job done, but it's more relational. I'm not trying to take us on a guilt trip. I just want to highlight that we probably tend to see ourselves as the parent or the older sibling in that situation. We're blessed and we're able to do four, but sometimes we don't take the longer way, the more relational way. And we're probably uncomfortable considering ourselves as being the kid in the story needing help with our homework. Today, how do we understand what it means to do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility, regard others as better than ourselves? Not looking to our own interests, but to the interests of others. To reference the book from the children's story, how are we listening so as to hear when others speak? How are we putting ourselves in a position to learn from others rather than teaching them? One of the last verses mentions working out your own salvation with fear and trembling. This isn't implying a form of works righteousness as if we can work our way to salvation, but instead Paul is concerned here with how believers live out their salvation here and now in the world. Paul is writing to the community in Philippi to help them realize one's potential or strength, just as Christ demonstrated, is intended to be directed at one's neighbor and not one's self. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility, regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. I don't mind sharing that I'm still learning about grace and its values. When I saw that I was preaching on being brave in engagement, I had to stop and ask, what does engagement mean? Is it about engagement with Scripture, with each other, with the community? Engagement is such a nuanced word. You know, you can say, I have a prior engagement, so I'm not able to stay. You can say, I bought an engagement ring in war. There are rules of engagement. So I asked some people more familiar with engagement about what this means to them. Engagement is active, respectful, seeking out our community, both inside and out, in dialogue. Engaging our neighbors can look like having discussions about important social issues and finding common ground to make our world better, more just. In the past, Uncommon Grace events were part of this, as we talked about human trafficking and environmental stewardship. The terms thought leadership and affecting social change are linked to engagement. Engagement is intended to involve people of all ages and stages. It's active and part of the call Jesus extends to come and follow me, where we think, but also do. Engagement is not passive, but about being compelled by God's love and grace to grow in our relationships with God and with neighbors. I think it's important for us to consider what it means to be brave in engagement. But I also think it's important to hold Philippians 2 in front of us as a mirror. There are lots of ways that unity and humility are tested at Grace. The past 20 months have presented a number of challenges to unity, and not just because of being physically apart. Unity has been called into question when flags were removed, when they were put back, how they were put back, how they're displayed now. Disunity has been presented when red paint was splattered on Grace's doors. Do we take it down? When do we take it down? What happens to the doors next? What about a lead minister? How are decisions being made? And by whom? Why is session taking so long to provide us a response around the remits? What about the music and the hymns being used? What if they're not the ones I like? What if they're from within the last 100 years? Can they still be meaningful? The list can go on and on, and unfortunately, I'm afraid it will. I don't want to come across as speaking down to you, even though I am in a pulpit and physically above most of you, but I am trying to speak as one among you. Where is the humility for grace as a whole? Lots of individuals display Christ in their lives and do so humbly, but as a congregation, I don't know if that's the case. Let's listen again to these words from Paul. If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Jesus didn't do things for himself. He served others. He emptied himself and became completely subservient and humble. The ministry he did for others, even though the people grumbled, even though they accused him of perverting their traditions and beliefs, because he knew it wasn't about him. It was about reconciling the world to God. The things we talk about, it's not about you. It's not about what I want and getting my way. It's about everyone else. Do you know who God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit is? Can we learn more? Sure, but if we are already believers, what difference does the flag or the hymn really make? Until we have unity and humility as Christ did, engagement will never reach its full potential. We shouldn't bother to ask where the young people are, why this or why that, until we can look in the mirror and say, wow, Grace, I see unity and humility reflected from you. I'll end soon, but I want us to think about two things in Canada's history and present. Today's Remembrance Sunday, when we pause to remember the sacrifice of women and men who answered the call to service. We know how devastating war can be and the atrocities that occur. But for those who humbly put the needs of others ahead of themselves so that there could be peace, it's worth remembering. We're called to remember their costly sacrifices so that such conflict, such pain and suffering doesn't take place again. Flags are not only a grace issue, but a national one. Flags on federal buildings have flown at half-mast across the country since May 30th in response to the recovery of hundreds of unmarked graves at Kamloops by the site of a former Indian residential school. It was announced last week that flags on Parliament Hill's Peace Tower and all government buildings will be raised at sunset on November 7th and lowered at sunrise on November 8th to recognize Indigenous Veterans Day. They will then be raised again before being lowered on November 11th, Remembrance Day. After those ceremonies, the flags will fly at full mast on government buildings. And the decision took time because parties needed to be in dialogue with each other. The needs of one another needed to be considered so that in humility there could be unity. The time for listening and dialogue is long overdue. And I want to read a few sentences that I came across on my study leave around reconciliation with Indigenous peoples. This was written by Reverend Peter Bush, a Presbyterian minister and moderator of the 143rd General Assembly, which was in 2017. In a chapter from the book Pathways of Reconciliation, Reverend Bush writes, "An apology cannot be a one-time thing. It may need to be made on many occasions and in many circumstances. We are at the beginning of a process that could take a long time and which is apt to be painful for all. But it is clearly the way towards reconciliation and holds the promise of new life for the whole church. Apology repetition reminds us of our motivation for starting this arduous journey in the first place, and the repeating of the apology rekindles that motivation. Apology repetition does not lead to a renewed commitment to the hard work of reconciliation. Apology repetition that does not lead to a renewed commitment to the hard work of reconciliation is repeating, but a repeating of empty words. Apology repetition at its best adds fresh vistas to the vision dreamed and hoped for, firing the imagination of the next generation of church leaders toward what could be. Apology repetition points to a new way of life, allowing people in a new time to make the choice to live into that new future. Like our prayers of confession, being brave in engagement means opening ourselves up to recognizing where we have fallen short, whether because of past actions like the Presbyterian Church in Canada's involvement with the residential school system, or because of current ones like a lack of unity and humility. But we cannot simply continue the ways we are used to, in ways that may be familiar but are actually destructive. Let the same mind be in us that was in Christ Jesus. The mind, the way of being that was in Christ Jesus, is now supposed to be in the body of Christ, the church. This claim compels us to measure or at least check our priorities. And what a great time as we discuss our strategic plan and priorities for the next 3 years. How is humility and concern for others being demonstrated? How are we practicing unity and humility? How do we not only advocate and care for the voiceless and powerless, but also listen to them and learn from them who are now finding their voice, those whose voices are no longer able to be silenced? This isn't just some missional push. This is what Jesus did. And as Christ's body, we are called to continue the work embodied and demonstrated by our Lord in unity and humility. It's not easy work, but it's important work. Essential work, not just for us today, but for the church that God is calling Grace to be now and in the future, and the people God is calling us to be today and tomorrow. Amen. Our next hymn is number 727, Let There Be Light. I'll invite you to stand if you're able as we sing. guess I'm only emotional because I care. I guess one of the good things before the pandemic, there wasn't too much live streaming, but I guess it'll be on the internet forever now. But in any case, that's all right. But with all our emotions, whatever we carry with us, let us come before God in our prayers of intercession. Let's pray together. Eternal God, we gather in this time of remembrance, grateful that you hold each one of us in your memory and your mystery, now and for all the time to come. Today we remember all those who served to uphold justice and freedom in the wars of the last century, in conflicts of our own generation, and in peacekeeping and relief efforts around the world. We pray especially for those who gave the ultimate sacrifice and died in their service for others. And we pray for those who carry scars on their bodies and minds, having returned from conflict. We remember their courage, and we pray for their families who still ache for lives surrendered at a great cost. We pray for the victims of conflict, hiding in forgotten corners of the world, longing for safety and peace. We pray for people in Afghanistan who fear for their lives and their future. We remember victims of violence in our own country, still fearful and uncertain about what the future holds for them. Give us the courage to speak out for their protection and recovery, and to act in ways that promote justice, loving kindness, and humility. God, we pray for those among us who struggle day by day, those who must cope with the fear of forgetting those who matter most to them, and those who face the fear of being forgotten. Help us remember to reach out in comfort and support so that no one is forgotten. We pray for those who are in pain and hurt deeply. We pray for those in hospital and for those recently released. We hold intention that there are loved ones who have received treatment and are getting better, and there are those whose conditions will not improve. God bless them, and may they know your presence and peace. May you surround their families in comfort and strength. Listen to us as we lift up before you now those on our hearts and minds in this time of silence. We give thanks for the life of Jim Gibson and that he is experiencing new life through you. We give thanks for all those who have passed from this world into your loving arms. We pray for their family and loved ones. God, we remember those around us who carry on under the burden of sad and hard memories, those weighed down by grief, disappointment, anger, pain, and loss. We pray for people with mental illness trying to get better. We pray for those with strained relationships and beginning a difficult journey of separation. Inspire us to offer a listening ear and an understanding heart whenever we can. God of all the ages past, hope of years to come, help us to remember you day by day. May we live with the mind of Christ, united in your will and humble in our calling. Send your Spirit among us so that we do not rely on our own understanding or desires, but are willing to go where you lead us. May we engage with others and be open to learning and growing in new ways. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you, choir. Let us pray and give thanks for our offerings of time, talents, and treasures. Receive our gifts this day, O God, and bless them with your love and power. Use them in the struggle for justice and the work for healing and peace undertaken by your faithful people here and everywhere. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 607, Ye Watchers and Ye Holy Ones. I'll invite you to stand as we sing together. Friends, let us not look to our own interests, but to the interests of others. Let us be of the same mind that was in Christ Jesus. And as we go forward in unity and humility, may we be united in the Holy Spirit, renewed by our Savior Jesus Christ, and may we know that we are always loved by God. Amen.